correct? I'm assuming.
That's right.
Okay. Now, how old were you when you got diagnosed with type 2 diabetes? Because you sound kind of young.
36.
Okay. So, all right, here's the deal. Type 2 diabetes is when the body stops listening to insulin. And this is true for everybody out there with type 2 diabetes, and there's millions of people with it. You're in good company, Nancy. Lots of folks are dealing with type 2 diabetes, which is a type of resistance to insulin. The body basically stops listening to insulin. The reason the body stops listening to insulin is because it's been bombarded with insulin for decades. And over the course of time, the body just stops listening. Whenever something happens over and over and over again, the body tends to tune down its receptivity. It's kind of like when you go to a rock concert and the music's really, really, really loud. Over the course of time, your ears adjust to the sound of the music, and you kind of get less, your ears become less sensitive to the noise. Well, the same thing happens to cells. They become less sensitive to chemicals that they're bombarded with all of the time. So the trick to making your cells more sensitive to insulin is to reduce the secretion of insulin by eating less insulin-spiking foods. This is the number one strategy and the most powerful non-medical strategy, the most powerful strategy that you could ever use for reducing your reliance on drugs if you have type 2 diabetes. Reduce your intake of insulin-spiking foods. Now, the second strategy is going to be to sensitize your body's response to insulin with nutritional supplements. I'll tell you about that in a second. But first and foremost, simply by reducing your intake of fruit juices and breads and pastas and cereals and certainly cakes and candies and anything sweet, just by reducing your intake of these kinds of foods, you will begin to resensitize your body to insulin. It's very ironic that the American Diabetic Association tells you to eat many of these kinds of foods, especially what they call whole grains. I'm telling you don't want to eat those kinds of foods. How ironic is it that as we've had more and more input from the American Diabetic Association, we've had more and more diabetes. Clearly what they're telling us is not working. And from a biochemical perspective, it can't work because whole grains and the kinds of foods that they recommend that you eat are insulin-spiking foods. The more insulin your pancreatic cells are making, the less likely your cells are going to be to listen. So what you have to do is you have to reduce your intake of these foods. That move alone, simply by doing that alone, you're going to begin to resensitize your cells' ability to your cells' listening ability. They'll be listening better to insulin. Fasting can also help. Intermittent fasting can also help resensitize your insulin, your cells' insulin sensitivity.
Now, really?
And that alone is all you need to do, really. There's more, but that alone will make a huge difference. The second thing you want to do is you want to start to take in nutrients that sensitize a cell to insulin, and there's many of them. The B vitamins are probably the most important, and specifically vitamins B1 and B3, maybe B12 and biotin as well, can have a resensitizing properties. That B1 is thiamine and B3 is niacin. You'll get all of those in the Beyond Tangy Tangerine. Personally, if it was me, I'd be throwing in 100 milligrams or so of timed-release niacin, which you can get from a health food store. Vitamin B12, as I say, can also resensitize cells to insulin, and so can the B vitamin biotin. And the B vitamin-like substance, choline, can have that effect, too. There's some amino acids that can have a resensitizing effect. Taurine and arginine stand out in importance, maybe a gram or two of arginine powder every day, and then maybe 100 to 500 milligrams of taurine every day can have a nice resensitizing effect. Then there are minerals that can resensitize cells' response to insulin. Probably the two most important are chromium and vanadium. Both of those are found in the Sweeties product. I'd be using a couple of Sweeties after all of your meals. Zinc is also extremely important for the sugar response. 50 milligrams a day of zinc picolinate is a must-have for everybody, really, but especially if you're dealing with diabetes, type 2 diabetes. You always want to balance out your zinc with copper, maybe 2 to 4 milligrams of copper. And magnesium is also stupendously important for helping the body with its insulin response. I'd be using the OsteoMag product from Youngevity or taking a magnesium supplement, maybe 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams a day. Some additional supplements that can help you resensitize the insulin response. One of the most important is something called alpha lipoic acid, which we've talked about periodically on this program. 2 to 300 milligrams a day of alpha lipoic acid may be in your interest. And then working on the digestive system is always a good idea. Blood sugar problems follow very often digestive problems. So using probiotics and digestive enzymes and lecithin after meals, all the things we talked talk about for improving the apple cider vinegar, by the way, can be really helpful for diabetes. I'd be using apple cider vinegar in addition to being helpful for the digestive system. I'd be using a teaspoonful or a tablespoonful of apple cider vinegar after all of your meals. And then there was one more thing I was going to tell you. Oh, cinnamon, actually. Cinnamon and fenugreek are two herbs or spices. Cinnamon's a spice. Fenugreek is an herb. Both of those can have a nice balancing effect and help improve insulin sensitivity. So there's tremendous options for you, Nancy. And the neat thing about everything I just told you, no side effects, Zippo side effects. Unlike the and they're cheap, too. Unlike your prescription drugs, which are loaded with side effects, very unpleasant side effects, they'll accelerate the aging process. They'll increase the rate that your body breaks down. They'll cost you money. You'll have to deal with a doctor and a pharmacy and an insurance company. None of those things will happen when you use nutritional supplements or the herbs or the apple cider vinegar. And they're all wonderfully effective, wonderfully effective. Nobody has to be condemned to diabetes or diabetic symptoms if you practice good lifestyle strategies, laying off of insulin-spiking foods and using the supplements. Got to move on. Nancy, anything else you want to add or ask?
Well, I'm also on a statin drug.
Well, they're poisoning you, Nancy. Your doctor is not being very nice. Is it the same doctor who's giving you all these medications?
Yes.
Well, you know, I don't want to get myself all mad and freaked out because that's the only thing that's going to happen. That's just what doctors do, all right? That's okay. How they operate. You don't have to comply. Let them poison themselves or their own family. You don't have to be poisoned. Thanks, Nancy. Got to move on. Appreciate your call. Gosh, that makes me so angry. One doctor is putting this poor woman on all of these medications. I wonder if that doctor told Nancy about vitamin B1 or B3 or B12. All right, I'm Pharmacist Ben. We're coming back with more of your phone calls. 855-660-4261 is our number. We'll be back right after this.
My name is Kay Swirling, and I am in the early part of my 10th decade. I want to discuss the issue of pharmaceuticals versus minerals and vitamin supplements. I remember a discussion between my mother and me. It was at that time that canned vegetables and fruits were introduced into the U.S. market. It was some time before my mother and others felt comfortable with food in cans. That was also the time when drugstores offered for sale cough syrup and aspirins and not much else. Let's fast forward to this decade, the here and now. Simple drugstores are large corporations with the message that they are the ones who have the power to cure human ills. Meanwhile, the battle continues with minerals and vitamins being the answer to human ills. Who will win the battle? I believe and hope it will be the belief in the power of vitamins and minerals over that of the toxic chemicals in prescription drugs. What do you think?
So we decided to upgrade the look of our home.
You know, improve the curb appeal.
We decided to add the look of stone to the exterior.
We really like the stacked stone look.
Yeah, but when I checked into the price, it was ridiculous. No way could we afford it.
Then a friend told me about Genstone. Genstone.
Genstone comes in lightweight panels made of polyurethane. They've actually engineered the hassle out of installation. No mortar, no mesh. It was easy. Even I could do it.
We just screwed the panels to the wall and it looks like stone. I mean, it really looks like stone.
Yeah, from the box to the wall in minutes.
We love the look of our home now.
And Genstone is durable, comes with a 25-year warranty, and offers additional R-value for insulation.
If you want the look of stone at a price you can afford, call Genstone.
At 855-955-STONE. Trust me, you'll save money.
And you'll love the look.
855-955-STONE. That's 855-955-7866.
I will never forget the day my son Jeremy told me he hated me and slammed the door in my face. I'm behavioral therapist Janet Lehman. Behavior problems can turn the child you love and your life into a nightmare. That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the step-by-step program that shows you how to fix the worst behavior problems and get your child to respect and listen to you again. No matter what the behavior, defiance, backtalk, angry outbursts, disrespect, we can help you stop it. Now you can get the Total Transformation for free. All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. You can keep it forever for free.
Limited number of free programs available. Call now 1-888-912-1595. 1-888-912-1595. That's 1-888-912-1595. 1-888-912-1595.
It's hard to imagine when things are going reasonably well just how quickly things can change. But what would it take? Economic collapse? Massive crop failure? Chemical or biological attack? So many situations could find you in the grocery looking to pick up food for your family only to find that the shelves are empty. There's nothing. Don't let that happen. Act today to make sure that if it ever comes to that, you and your family will be provided for. Visit freezedryguy.com to look at the wide variety of survival foods available. Freeze-dried foods from the Freeze Dry Guy store longer, rehydrate faster, are nutritionally superior to, and taste better than any other long-term storage food available. Visit freezedryguy.com or call toll-free 866-404-3663. FreezeDryGuy.com.
Not just an alternative to the mainstream media. We're the premier independent talk radio network. We are G.
We are back on the Bright Side. I am Pharmacist Ben. 855-660-4261 is our number. Let's go out to California and welcome Jim to the Bright Side. Welcome, buddy. What's going on?
Well, I've got a friend that's got pulmonary hypertension.
Okie dokie.
Any suggestions for him?
Yeah, lots of stuff. Pulmonary hypertension is high blood pressure that's related to the respiratory system, and it's especially connected to the stress response, as we were talking about earlier on the program. First thing that you want to do is you want to relax the body. Lots of ways to do that. Mental relaxation strategies, emotional relaxation strategies. I'm not going to get too much into that. But as I was talking about at the beginning of the program, hot tubs, hot baths, breathing techniques, all of these can help relax the body, and they can help relax hypertension. Pulmonary hypertension, as it regards the lungs, can be very, very serious, by the way. It's nothing to mess around with. From a nutritional standpoint, reducing your intake of fast-burning sugars can help relax pulmonary hypertension issues. Using the nutrients that help you stabilize sugar also have a relaxing effect on hypertension, on the pressure in the pulmonary arteries. That's what pulmonary hypertension is, specifically magnesium. I'd be using around 2,000 to 3,000 milligrams of magnesium a day. You want to take higher amounts of magnesium at nighttime because it does have quite a significant relaxing effect. Vitamin C is super, super important for all respiratory issues, and it also has antihypertensive effects. I'd be using 1,000 to 2,000 milligrams minimum of vitamin C a day, but anywhere from 5,000 to 10,000 milligrams is not too much vitamin C. You'll get vitamin C as well as magnesium in the Beyond Tangy Tangerine product from Longevity. Essential fatty acids can also be helpful for all respiratory issues and all hypertension issues. I'd be using the omega-3s from the Ultimate EFAs. Omega-3s have a more relaxing effect, have a significant anti-inflammatory and relaxing effect. Omega-6s have the opposing effect. You need them both, however, and I'd be using the Ultimate EFAs, probably 9 of them a day, in addition to your entire Mighty 90, of course. When I talk about magnesium and I talk about essential fatty acids and vitamin C, I'm not diminishing or marginalizing the importance of the Mighty 90 essential nutrients. They're all important, but these three in particular, and a couple more I'll tell you about here, have some specific relevance when it comes to respiratory health as well as being antihypertensive. Vitamin E is super, mega important for the lungs and for the heart and for the blood vessels. You're not going to find vitamin E in foods very well, so you might want to get on about 400 international units of vitamin E a day. Vitamin E also has a nice blood-thinning effect, and pulmonary hypertension can sometimes cause blood clots, which can really be a problem. So keeping the blood flowing smoothly is also very, very important. Vitamin E can help you with that. Vitamin A might be helpful as well. Vitamin A is also good for all respiratory health issues, around 20,000 1,000 international units of vitamin A. Lots more you could do. N-acetylcysteine can also be helpful. I'd be using maybe 500 to 600 milligrams of N-acetylcysteine. Most importantly, please understand, pulmonary hypertension is serious, serious business. Pulmonary hypertension can cause problems with shortness of breath and chest pain, racing heartbeat, and as I say, blood clots are possible, if not likely, over the course of time. And the worst thing that can happen is heart failure, and that's the most common cause of death in people who have pulmonary hypertension, and it is not insignificant. There's no cure necessarily for pulmonary hypertension, but you can reverse it if you do lifestyle changes, especially relaxation techniques.